I am here today to share my life journey with you guys through this four-letter word, SAFE. If you understand the meaning of these letters, they will help you overcome many challenges in the future. But I will come to them later. I was born in Sierra Leone in 1982. As we all may know now, that Sierra Leone is a wealthy country by natural resources. But due to mismanagement, Sierra Leone is one of the poorest nations on the planet. And the area where I was born, Tembe Town, is one of the worst slums in the capital city, Freetown. Both my parents never had any education. They had 2 to 3 odd jobs that they do, and they work 8 days a week. Now, what do I mean by 8 days? They work from Monday to Monday throughout the year without any day off. As poor as my parents were, they also decided to have many children. Why? I don't know. So 11 of us in total, and I was child number 8. 3 of my brothers born before me weren't so lucky. 2 of them died at birth, and 1 of them died at infancy due to the lack of medical facilities in the country. And also Sierra Leone had the highest mortality rate in the world. And at the age of 6, I was adopted. Our parents were so poor that they couldn't help to look after myself and my siblings. Living with my adopted family was some of the toughest challenges I faced at my childhood, because they were tough. Constant whooping was part of the punishment, and I was receiving an average of 3 beatings every week. And at weekends, I worked from 6 in the morning till about 8 at night. So when I was at the age of 9 years old, I decided I've had enough with this, so I ran away. I was living from place to place, but most of the time I was living on the street. So at this same time in 1991, the Civil War broke out in Sierra Leone, where we saw thousands of young children within the ages of 3 and 15 were recruited as child soldiers to fight in the rebel forces. And I was caught up in that, not as a rebel or as a fighter, but as a victim that was captured, tied, and beat many times by foreign soldiers. Because of my physical structure, I was mistaken for a rebel. So while all this was going on, my parents separated. So my mom moved to a little place called Hill Station, where she lived. So just on the side of a little house, as we can see on the photo, lies 3 tennis courts. I had fallen in love with this wonderful game. So one day I went home to my dad, and I told my dad, I said, "Dad, I want to become a tennis player. I want to play tennis." And my dad looked at me, and he goes, "Son, if I ever see you play that rich white man sport, I'm going to cut all your fingers." And he wasn't joking, by the way. But anyway, I went on and defied my dad, and I started playing tennis. But as poor kids, we didn't have a racket, we couldn't afford it. So what did we do? We got plywood, we cut them into the shape of a table tennis bat, and we used them to play most of the time. And then at the age of 10, I find out that the little kids that were playing tennis for Sierra Leone will receive an allowance mount up to $250 and a national tracksuit. As a little kid, this was when the real madness and obsession of me becoming a tennis player really, really started. So with my wooden racket and everything, I was practicing. And then in 1995, at the age of 13, I had my first opportunity to play in the national tournament to qualify. So here I was in the quarterfinal, and I noticed a white guy was sitting outside watching my match. Okay? So funny enough, the following day, this guy turned up with a brand new pair of tennis shoes. Mind you all, prior to this day, I've never ever wore tennis shoes in my life. I played tennis barefoot because we couldn't afford to get shoes. So here I was running around playing, because running is part of my strength. And then all of a sudden in the first set, I realized that maybe this was not the right time for me to be experimenting playing tennis with the shoes, because I couldn't move. My feet were hurting me. So I went to the umpire and I said to him, "Please, sir, can I just take these shoes off, because they're absolutely killing me?" And he looked at me like some prehistoric throwback kids, and he go, "Okay, yeah, you can take it off." So I took them off, put them in the corner, and here I was again running left to right. And what happened next? I lost. I was furious and angry. Why? Because I've started blaming this guy. Why in the world did he bring me these shoes at this most important time of my life? And now I've lost this match. And I was crying, laced the shoes together, walked all the way 4 miles back to my parents crying. But one thing I learned from losing and failing is that if you give up, you're not going anywhere. So I continued to play. Till I was 14, I tried again, and then 15, I tried more than 3, 4, 5 times, and I keep just falling short. But something happened to me at the age of 16, which changed my life perspective for good. This was actually on Valentine's Day, February 14, 1998, 4 days after I turned 16. I was sleeping in my little room where I always sleep, and then one of my best friends, who happened to be one of my heroes, come in and tap me on the shoulder. He goes, "Sam, we need to leave now." And then I woke up from my sleep, jumped outside. It was chaotic. Military jet flying, dropping bombs. And there was a lot of soldiers running all over the place, people running from one end to the other, and missiles approaching from one end of the city to another. An international intervention had started in Sierra Leone. So we wandered out to the tennis court, and here we were, me and my friend wondering what to do. And then another friend of ours come and call my name. He says, "Sam, just come over here and see the bomb explosion. The military jet has dropped a bomb." So I took a few steps, and all of a sudden, I had rapid AK-47 shot behind me. So when I turn around, my best friend has been shot multiple times on the chest. So I run up to him screaming for help, but it was too late. So he fell face down, and I watched my best friend, my hero, took his last breath. At this point, standing close to me was my precious mom, staring at me right in my eyes, saying nothing, but just tears running down her face. And I look at my mom, and I promise myself from that day, I'll do whatever it takes to stay alive and never again to see such grief in the face of my mom. So let's fast forward 8 months after that, in October of 1998, I finally made it into the Sierra Leone national team. So I received over $250, which $150 I gave to my mom to sustain the family for half a year, and $50 I gave to my dad, which he was happy and proud of me. And I was certain from then on that my dad was not going to cut my fingers for playing this rich white man's sport. So again, since then, I continue to represent Sierra Leone till the 9th All-African Games in Algeria, which is the biggest sports event in Africa. And as a honor, I was honored to be the flag bearer for my county, Sierra Leone. And I remember that day walking through the tunnel into the stadium of over 50,000 people. And that was some of the most proudest and most happiest time of my life. So after 2007, I've managed now to become an LTA, the Lawn Tennis Association, and PTA, Professional Tennis Registry Coach. And tennis has given me the opportunity to be able to travel to every part on the planet, working with different players from all nationality and different background. And also today, I'm a new author with my own book, titled How Tennis Saved My Life, subtitled Play Tennis, Not War. So to come to the conclusion of my life journey from Sierra Leone, from Tembe Town, from extreme poverty, being adopted with the harsh treatment, and then living on the street and the civil war, and also find tennis and to where I am today to speak to you, I'm going to go back to those four-letter words that I start with. What did they really, really mean to our life? Struggles, adversity, failures, and endure. Life is very, very tough, and I can tell each and every one of you here today. But as long as you all choose what you want to do and you know what you do and go after it, no matter how many times people shut their door at you, no matter how many times you feel that the whole world is against you, you just need to focus on what you want to do and have passion for it and go after it no matter what. So I have that. I never gave up on my dream. I never stopped trying. You see how many things happened to me. So I have countless amounts of struggles, and I went through so many adversity, and as you can see, my bucket was full of failures. But one thing I did was I endure each and every one of those things that come my way, and I come out stronger on the other side. And this is why I'm here today, to share my life journey with you all. And I do hope that in the future, this will be you sharing your story with the next generation. I just want to advise you guys as well, because you're all here as students, and to say that life is a dream. It's a dream until you wake up. And your dreams will become your goals when you actually write them down. And those goals will become achievable when you take the necessary action. If you don't take action, you're not going to go anywhere, so you need to take those action. And lastly, before I leave here, I just want to remind you guys that you all here today, you're the future generation leaders of our planet. And I'm encouraging you all to make sure you go out there and learn to love every mankind on this planet, no matter what their race, religion, nationality, and genders are. You must always share love and passion for people. Because I believe that under this same cloud, we all live as one human race. So, for me, with all this experience in tennis over the years, and the past 3 months, I've been able to travel to more than 20 countries, working with players from Spain to Africa to the United States. And just 4 days ago, I came back from Canada working with an American player. So tennis has given me this passion, this opportunity to travel the world and meet with so many people and meet with wonderful people. And I've also lived my life with some of the most cruel people on the planet during my time in the civil war in Sierra Leone. But today, I just thank my parents and everyone for, you know, being there for me and loving me, especially my mom. And also find something that I have passion for. Like my dad said to me, well, I'll cut all your fingers if you play tennis. Because to his own world, playing tennis was a strange sport to him. He wanted me to become a doctor. He didn't want me to end up like him having 2-3 jobs where he has almost less than £3 a month for his salary. So I took all this and everything that happened to me and put them together and make me become a stronger person. And this is why I'm here today to share this story with you. And I do hope that you guys will go out there and do whatever you can to make people happy, find your passion, and do whatever you choose to do and make this world a better place. I want to thank you all for your time, and I do hope that you'll go on to make this world a better place. Thank you all.